guests of the fabulous holiday of Shavuot. It's evening of learning sponsored by Congregation Beth Shalom, Moriah Congregation, along with my own congregation, North Suburban Bethel. For those who don't know me, I'm Rabbi Schwab. And it's great to be able to join together. And we're so excited to also have the Congregation B'nai Tikva as well with us this evening. And we hope that everyone will enjoy learning together. So last year, when the pandemic hit, most of our congregations were struggling to figure out how to do anything. You know, how are we going to do Shabbat? How are we going to daven together? How are we going to do Shavuot? And many of us had our traditions about what we did for Shavuot in particular in Tikkun, and we just couldn't do it the same way. So we partnered together and organized the whole week of learning, and it was really fantastic. That was when Zoom was new and fresh, and it was exciting. This year, we figured I've done enough Zoom. It was hard to put together a whole week of it, but we really wanted to do a joint learning session between our congregations again. And we thought, what better way to do it than to have a fabulous headliner to bring us into the Shavuot spirit. So this evening, in a moment, Rabbi Warner is going to introduce Dr. Schorsch. But in terms of how things are going to go, she is going to speak to us for a little while. And then when she's finished, there'll be an opportunity for a question and answer. If you do have questions that you want to ask, please put them in the chat function to me, Michael Schwab, and I will try to have your questions answered. I will kind of moderate. I may end up grouping your questions with similar questions, so it might not be me reading exactly the question you wrote, but hopefully we'll get at the content that you are trying to ask. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Rabbi Warner from CBS.
Erev Tov, good evening. It's a distinct honor to be asked to introduce Dr. Rebecca Schorsch. She is the Director of Jewish Studies at the Rochelle Zell Jewish High School, where she teaches rabbinics, Bible, and Jewish thought, and plays an active role in shaping the school as a member of the educational leadership team of the administration. Dr. Schorsch chairs the Lishma program, where faculty and staff get together monthly on a voluntary basis to study and reflect upon a range of themes connected to Jewish tradition, Jewish calendar, and general themes of interest to us as individuals and a community of educators. A recent recipient of the prestigious Covenant Award for Excellence in Jewish Education, 2015, and founding board member of the Chicago Jewish Day School, a multi-denominational Jewish elementary school in the city of Chicago, Dr. Schorsch continues to be active in the Jewish community at large through board service, adult Jewish education, and community work. Dr. Schorsch holds degrees from the University of Chicago, a PhD in History of Judaism, a master's degree in Jewish history from JTS, and a BA in European history from Columbia University. She is married to Dr. Scott Moses and has three children, Ada, Nathaniel, and Livia. Welcome, Dr. Schorsch. We are eager to hear what you have to share with us.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me. I just admitted that for all the experience of this hard year of learning amidst the pandemic, this is actually my first Zoom event beyond the walls of our school, even the virtual walls of our school. So it's really quite an amazing thing to see all the names and all the participants who can come in from all over the place. So I'm really, really honored to be asked to be here. And I'm really grateful for this opportunity. It's a hard moment, for us as we sit here in Chicago. My heart's heavy, all of our hearts are heavy with what's going on in Israel, Palestine, and just a lot of thoughts and prayers for peace and for Sheket, and we should all be Rodef Shalom. We should all just be chasing after peace. A little bit of this attempt to think about Torah and think about Jewish learning when we're kind of barely crawling out of the period of COVID-19, and also with just Israel, Palestine, Jerusalem kind of up in flames. I'm feeling myself to be I'm feeling myself to be a little bit, you know, with lots and lots and lots of, you know, difference, but a little bit in what it must have felt like for the Israelites coming out of Egypt. And, you know, to say plague is an understatement, to say, you know, years of oppression is an understatement. Having just, you know, miraculously survived crossing the sea with, being chased and then witnessing oppressors, you know, drowning in the sea. I mean, just hard to imagine really. But what it would take then 3 months later to be ready for Torah and to be able to take it in and to be able to hear it and to be able to listen. It's really hard to imagine. So with a lot of differences, I think as we ready ourselves for Shavuot in 3 days and we try to separate out from all the hardship and all the, you know, just all the difficulties of our world, it is really important to try to lahavdil, to try to separate and to try to carve out sacred space and sacred time. So with that in mind, I just invite us all into this Zoom sacred space to do a little bit of Torah learning, and invite you to turn off your cell phones, invite you to close the other tabs on your screen, invite you to maybe, get into that headspace and heart space. What I'm really going to do here tonight is invite you into my classroom. And over the last however many years, I've been very lucky to teach in a very special room at Rochelle Zell Jewish High School, room 221. It's a big art room with big tables and lots of windows, and I can see the weather and we can see the snow and the flowers blooming and just lots of light. And we sit around seminar style and we have text open and Torah open and we talk to each other. So I'm gonna try to invite you into that space with me tonight. Normally, I would do much less talking, and we would open a text and you would be in dialogue with each other and in dialogue with the text and in dialogue with, you know, me through all that. But what I'm gonna do with you here tonight is I'm going to invite you to listen to two central texts. One is a famous address of Abraham Joshua Heschel. He delivered it at the White House in 1960 at the Conference on Children and Youth. And we're going to read a lot of passages from that text. And then the other texts I'm going to invite you to listen to and absorb and take in are texts from my students. We're going to read 4 excerpts of student work. And we're going to be in, so I'm going to orchestrate that dialogue between Heschel and student and concerns over Jewish learning. So I invite you into that dialogue. I invite you into that conversation. You'll be playing more of a trying to absorb and listen and take it all in. And I will speak for way longer than I normally speak. And then we will open it up and hopefully have a little bit of back and forth. So although the title for tonight is Imagining the Future of Jewish Learning, and we will imagine, and I will imagine with you the future of Jewish learning, it might have been a better entitled Some Wisdom from Room 221. For the Jewish future I imagine is at once already present as it is also already past. When I started working with teenagers at Camp Ramah, Wisconsin in 1987, I was struck immediately by 2 things. First, their genuine desire and openness to relationships with adults. And second, their desire to engage in serious, meaningful conversations. After nearly 18 years at Rochelle Zell Jewish High School, I'm still taken by the exciting combination of adolescent bravado and openness and the possibilities and complexities of their emergence, where individuation transpires amidst belonging to an ancient living tradition and covenantal community. Tonight, I draw deeply from 3 foundational experiential and textual sources: the source I mentioned from Abraham Joshua Heschel, the powerful voices of my students, and my own years of experience in the classroom. My contention is that Jewish learning now, as much as ever, if not more so, must be committed to Jewish and human flourishing as such. It must speak to the heart and mind, be purposeful and significant, deeply caring and humane, relational and demanding thought. Tonight, I begin by foregrounding lessons learned throughout this most difficult 14 months of learning, but my view is that the pandemic has mostly schooled us in familiar realities. We know that technology is a blessing and a curse and must be used carefully and thoughtfully, while online platforms thankfully enabled ongoing learning. While online platforms thankfully enabled ongoing learning and invaluable access, and there are so many instances across the world in the Jewish community of really creative, vibrant ways of bringing people together, food fests and music fests and learning of all kinds. But we know that online platforms tend to be better at delivering content than building a community of learners. They're better at content than conversation, better at subject knowledge than community building. They're exhausting, enabling endless distractions, undermining relational power of body language, eye contact, and silence. What else do we know? Despite the limitations of Zoom and hybrid learning, serious, meaningful content and discussion can emerge to excite, awaken, and engage even the most distracted students. And we know, once again, that we live in a society that is scary and vulnerable, a society that is scary. We are vulnerable. Our question is how to raise children amidst that reality, to foster optimism and hope and action, an orientation that neither denies reality nor despairs. We know and have known that teenagers feel tremendous pressure. They work hard and are exhaustingly busy. As such, the sudden gift of time afforded tragically by the pandemic was welcome. Later school start times for precious sleep, pass-fail grading to lessen time on schoolwork, and time gained without sports or extracurricular activities. My students narrated appreciating the return to activities they abandoned long ago in pursuit of achievement and college admission. For these reasons, while the cost of social isolation and loss of social activity was very difficult, national data reports that the initial release of academic pressures was a boon to mental health. But the release was short-lived. We know that 46% of parents report their teenagers' mental health has worsened during the pandemic, that 12 to 17-year-olds visiting emergency rooms for mental health reasons rose 31% for most of 2020 compared with 2019. The cause, studies show, is not social isolation, but the pressure to achieve, which intensified over the past year, even though initially it had lessened. Teenagers living in middle and upper middle class suburbs, places of high achieving professionals who emphasize the value of status and achievement when compared with poor and urban teenagers, evidently do worse on drug and alcohol abuse. In high achieving schools, that is schools where public and private institutions where students on average score in the top third on standardized tests and come from a variety of racial, regional, and socioeconomic backgrounds, adolescents suffer from symptoms of clinical depression and anxiety at rates 3 to 7 times higher than national norms for children their age. The pressure to excel in multiple academic and extracurricular pursuits is at the heart of their misery. At under-resourced schools, during the pandemic, students were more likely to report being stressed about family finances. But still, they say the top stressors are grades, assessments, and college. 57% of students said their parents' expectations for their performance stayed the same during the pandemic, while 34% said their expectations increased. When parents are asked to define success, they say wanting their children to be happy and healthy, have loving relationships, and give back to society. But when children are asked how they define success, they tend to describe a narrow path, getting good grades, going to college, securing high-paying jobs. The conclusion by one journalist who's also happens to be working on her doctorate in clinical psych, Esfahani Smith, reports on these findings. If we want more resilient kids coming out of the pandemic, we need to heed a lesson of this past year, that the pressure to achieve is crushing the spirits of many young people and should be dialed back. But we already knew that the pressure to achieve and was crushing the spirits of many young people, right? I've come to understand that the openness to the adult world I first glimpsed in teenagers in 1987 is two-sided. On the one hand, it means that the relationships at the heart of meaningful learning and forging a community of learners can be cultivated. On the other hand, the spirit of non-questioning, the absence of healthy teenage suspicion, I believe is part of the problem. What's to rebel against when generous and loving parents devote their time and money and guidance to their children's success? However, as an educator and with the Pesach Seder as a traditional model, I know that critical thought is at the heart of learning. We must invite and provoke questions, teach our children to ask, to be aware that our conditions were once different and could still be different, that we were once slaves and others are still enslaved, and to consider the very meaning of freedom. Torah and the world need us because the givens aren't necessarily what should be, and determining what should be requires awareness, attention, perspective, comparison, context, discernment, the study of history and current conditions to consider alternate possibilities. That is, determining what should be requires critical thinking and moral attunement. Abraham Joshua Heschel anticipates the risks to children raised solely for achievement, affluence, and status, as though foretelling our moment exactly in the 1960 address before the White House Conference on Children and Youth. Heschel states, man has to choose between awe and anxiety, between the divine and the demonic, between radical amazement and radical despair. A time without awe becomes an age of anxiety. Heschel suggests we pose the following essential question to ourselves. Who are we and what world are we asking children to join? Because for Heschel, education begins in the home and must be a pursuit of a lifetime. In the home is where our children's innate inclination towards appreciation and amazement is sparked, cultivated, and maintained. In dedicating time through Jewish practice and holidays that bind us to our past and one another through meals and conversation, in committing to pausing to recite daily brachot of appreciation and prayers of gratitude, in carving out 25 hours weekly for Shabbat, famously described by Heschel as a sanctuary in time, a palace whose traditional furnishings are not computer screens, whose concerns are not monetary, and whose preoccupation isn't productivity. Jewish practices and values foster attention to matters of significance, connection, reverence, awe, wonder, meaning, and purpose. That is the shaping of Jewish human beings. In Heschel's words, talent, knowledge, success are important to human existence. Yet talent without dedication, knowledge without reverence, success without humility may end in futility. Important is the premise that a life unexamined is not worth living. Yet it is just as vital to realize that life without commitment to what is greater than life is not worth living. Heschel describes the adverse conditions of his day. The problem is the spirit of the age, the denial of transcendence, vapidity of values, emptiness of the heart, the increased insensitivity to the imponderable quality of the spirit, the collapse of communication between the realm of tradition and the inner world of the individual. The central problem is that we do not know how to think, how to pray, how to cry, how to resist the deceptions of too many persuaders. There is no community of those who worry about integrity. Heschel condemns a world in which usefulness is thought to be the chief merit of nature, in which the attainment of power, the utilization of its resources, is taken to be the chief and only purpose of man and the universe. Man has indeed become primarily a tool-making animal, and the world is now a gigantic toolbox for the satisfaction of his needs. We no longer know how to justify any value except in terms of expediency. Humans act and think as if the sole purpose of the universe were to satisfy our needs. Home, inwardness, friendship, conversation are becoming obsolete, said Heschel. We have no friends, we have business associates. Conversation is disappearing. Watching television substitutes for the expression of ideas. Were it not for the reference to television, might you think these words were written today? We have hundreds of so-called friends today, but they are on Facebook. An ever more prevalent smart technology than television, eroding connection with others and ourselves, turning conversation into diatribe and dogma, polarizing us. The students I teach live the erosion of connection forged by their phones and social media. They know disconnection deeply, even as they also know the innumerable benefits the ease and access technology affords. This difficult pandemic year has only brought both sides of the equation to the foreground. I have taken to reading Heschel's address on children and youth with my 12th graders toward the end of their senior year in our modern Jewish thought class. Every year I am moved by how powerfully Heschel's words written 50 years ago still resonate. Our students surrounded by and struggling to serve success and achievement and having glimpsed a different way, affirm his critique and feel compelled by his vision. In 1960, Heschel asks, the basic issue is how young people can be brought up with a proper sense of responsibility in an affluent society. For wealth turns us into people who, quote, believe the world is indebted to us, that society is charged with duties toward us, and that our standard preoccupation is, what will I get out of life? Suppressed is the question, what will life, what will society get out of me? Heschel insists that the most urgent task faced by American education is to destroy the myth that accumulation of wealth and the achievement of comfort are the chief vocations of man. 50 years after Heschel delivered his address, the urgency, it seems to me, is as great as ever. Every year at the end of our senior modern Jewish thought class, students reflect upon what's been powerful, lasting, meaningful, or not in our studies. With wide latitude to choose from texts within and without our classroom, as well as the form their reflection takes, students create visual art, write poetry, letters, journals, and essays. One senior drew a picture of 10 slats or rungs of a ladder held together loosely by chains on the sides of each plank. His version of the Kabbalistic sefirot, his depiction of the emanations connecting the sacred and mundane. Here is part of his artist statement. Quote, at the end of the piece, the final link is blank. This emptiness depicts Heschel's passage, suppressed is the question, what will life, what will society get out of me? The chain is unfinished. Modern Jewish thought and the sometimes difficult process of observation and both inner and outer reflection is unremitting. In the artwork, the sequence ends with a blank space, the awe, the open territory for one to roam and fill with new observations and discoveries. Heschel poses a rather frightening question regarding a most horrifying and unknown topic, the future. Where will this chain go? Should it end or should it be continued? What wisdom can I carry into this blank space? The question haunts me as I embark on the next chapter of my life. What will society get out of me? Throughout this course, I have learned two major pieces of information about Judaism and theology. The first is that believing in God or worshiping God can be a personal event, which translates to the second piece of information, which is the worship of God within a community. In my artwork, I portray everything stemming from God. Similarly, as I live my life as a Jewish man, most of my values are induced by God and Judaism. I have learned how to branch outward using these principles and use Jewish lessons to help society, These can be encounters between only two people, but also national issues such as racism. I have learned that Jewish principles play a larger role in my life than I previously thought, and I hope to continue to carry out these mitzvot as I continue my journey. Back to Heschel. He urges us to modify the sole goal of education from socializing children into the norms of society to raising children able to challenge the norms when the spirit of the age fails. In his words, time has come to revise the notion of adjustment. To revise the notion of adjustment to society as the preoccupation of the educational process. Together with adjustment to society, we must cultivate a sense for injustice, impatience with vulgarity, a capacity for moral indignation, a will to readjust society itself when it becomes complacent and corrupt. No one with a sensitive conscience can feel well adjusted to a self-indulgent society, which is indifferent to the misery of millions of people. Can you imagine what it would look like to market Jewish day schools as, you know, come to our school, we'll make sure your child is maladjusted. Don't worry, we're taking care of the problem of adjustment and we're going a different way, right? I don't know how that would work so well, but that is what Heschel is calling for. Thankfully, I'm in the field of Jewish learning and, you know, math people and science people and English language people, they can do all their hardcore work of giving everyone skills to get jobs, you know, but Jewish studies, I think that we can have some space in there to be a little bit more radical. I ask you tonight, as I ask my students every year, if you think Heschel's description of the spirit of our age is still apt. How would you describe the spirit of our age? My students think Heschel's description is as apt as ever. For sure, there are Jewish and non-Jewish spaces and communities committed to Heschel's prescient description, robust, emerging, and flourishing pockets of learning and connection to counter the spirit of the age. There always are. Judaism has resources to be a profound, beautiful, countercultural pathway, a traditional and ongoing way to resist, even as it is also shaped by and is a part of the spirit of its age. From the Torah's injunction for every living being of an Israelite household to rest on Shabbat, through today's efforts to teach an ancient textual tradition and practice rituals requiring discomfort, sacrifice, and commitment, in a world overwhelmingly valuing productivity and economic and utilitarian metrics, raising Jewish children must be countercultural until our vision of the world aligns with how the world should be. Where every day of the week is a chance to do homework or make money, in a world where time is money, Judaism seeks to protect time as sacred, time to be still, to nap, to be quieter, to connect, to share a meal, to converse, to put aside technology and the weekday concerns, the pervasive and relentless chasing of success. I've been privileged to teach and lead in a community of integrity, as Heschel would say. Rochelle Zell Jewish High School, along with other such communities across the country and world, is a community of study and care and purpose. We're privileged to choose to educate our children in such a community. We know well, however, that privilege doesn't lead us to select communities of care. All we need to do is read Caitlin Flanagan's devastating article in The Atlantic recently on the state of private schools to see how the privileged, determinedly, anxiously, and ultimately unethically, try to amass more and more. We know that the college admission scandals perpetuated by wealthy elites concerned for their children's future to the point of planful deception despite their enormous wealth. Parents anxious over their children's future in turn raise children anxious over their future. Elementary schools field questions by parents of incoming kindergartners about college admissions. With educational success measured by college admissions and financial status, successful outcomes cannot be measured by values and meaning, compassion and care. A recent article by Yale law professor Daniel Markovitz, author of The Meritocracy Trap, describing how college became a ruthless competition divorced from learning, writes, "We have now traveled far enough down the path of competitive education that our age has spawned a literature of disenchantment over schooling. Some treatments emphasize the soullessness of students who know education only as a means of status. Others worry that instrumentalism kills once vibrant intellectual traditions, particularly in the humanities. Still others skewer elite schools for claiming to pursue justice when their bottom lines require them to help their overwhelmingly rich students get ahead. At Rochelle Zell, we resist, though we're not immune. Internally, we describe ourselves as a covenantal community, a community of commitment to one another, to our tradition, our community, our world, a community centering relationships between teacher and student, student and student, and students and text, a community of prayer, cherished all the more when COVID strained our ability to all gather and sing and mourn and be silent. Integrity, wholeness, at oneness, the alignment of purpose with action, Rochelle Zell attempts to have choices about how to teach, how to speak, how to listen, how to act within the school's walls and beyond, line up with Judaism's values, with our Jewish mission. We ask a lot of our students. We ask them to cultivate the maturity to be patient, to enter an ancient language and text, to reflect upon and recite daily prayer. We orient North Shore and Chicago Jewish teenagers, teenagers who easily could be in magnet Chicago public schools and nationally ranked suburban high schools, into a world of pause, sacrifice, gratitude, and commitment. We are, with Heschel and Judaism, a community which asks much of man. Heschel admonishes, we no longer know how to justify any value except in terms of expediency. Humans act and think as if the sole purpose of the universe were to satisfy our needs. As a result, he contends, quote, we not only distort our sight of the world by paying attention only to its aspects of power, we're reducing the status of man from that of a person to that of a thing. There is a strange cunning in the fact that when man looks only at that which is useful, he eventually becomes useless to himself. In reducing the world to an instrument, man himself becomes an instrument. The instrumentalization of the world leads to the disintegration of man. We underestimate the nature of man. The true question should be, who is man? The cardinal sin of our educational philosophy is that we have asked too little. Heschel thinks man's capable of profundity, of sacrifice, of love, of self-denial. The agony of contemporary man is the agony of a spiritually stunted man. The image of man is larger than the frame into which he has been compressed. In order to be human, man has to be more than a man. There is a divine stake in human existence, says Heschel. At the end of the first semester of our 11th grade Tanakh class, a year devoted to a course on Bereishit, students are asked to write an essay on the Torah's portrait of being and becoming a human. From the lofty and lowly origins of humans through the narrative of Cain and Abel, students are asked to choose a theme or two through which to illuminate the human condition portrayed in these grand, terse, open-ended narratives of Bereishit. Freedom and responsibility, the state of nature, creation, self-control and disobedience, relationship to God, religion, morality, violence are among the important concepts students consider. For Heschel, as for us, what is a human is a question to ponder, an idea, not a given. Every year, we conduct exit interviews with our graduating seniors. Among many powerful and moving descriptions of student appreciation, the following two stories of 11th grade Bible class stand out. One student spoke of her time reading the first 11 chapters of Bereishit in Hebrew, silently, slowly, as though for the first time. She loved the quiet, prolonged reading of text, the open-ended delving into Torah, transforming the noise of a high school classroom into the sounds of sacred space. Another student spoke of her working in Chavruta with her learning partner, responding to a question they had posed on motherhood in the Sarah and Hagar narratives. Poring over commentaries, outlining charts and culling sources, she loved the messy array of traditional and modern interpretive possibilities surrounding her, excited to creatively and carefully shape the abundance into her own meaningful interpretation. These two educational highlights reflect a shared joy of feeling lost, or perhaps better, found. Immersion in silence and in relationship with text and one another, of basking in Torah. Back to Heschel. There is no sense of responsibility without reverence for the sublime in human existence. Without a sense of dignity, without loyalty to a heritage, without an awareness of the transcendence of living. Self-respect is the fruit of discipline. The sense of dignity grows with the ability to say no to oneself. I shudder to think of a generation devoid of a sense of wonder and mystery. We are fostering a type of man who lives by borrowed words rather than by his own innate sense of the unutterable, by the stirring of his own heart, which no language can declare. We prepare the pupil for employment, for holding a job. We do not teach him how to be a person, how to resist conformity, how to grow inwardly, how to say no to his own self. We teach him to adjust to the public. We do not teach him how to cultivate privacy. We are involved in numerous activities. We must not forget the meaning of stillness. We set a premium on togetherness. We should also acknowledge the value of solitude. Eloquence is important, but so is stillness. Skills are vital, but so is self-restraint. The following reflection is from an artist statement appended to a portrait the student drew of a man with a television for a head, based on Heschel's idea that our modern moment is characterized by people who prefer entertainment to learning. Here is her writing. As this year comes to a close, I've spent many hours reflecting on my educational experiences. To no fault of my teachers, the system of education fosters rote memorization over critical thinking and commodification of students through grades. However, in modern Jewish thought, I experienced a different kind of classroom, one that asked little of me in regards to memorization and much of me in regards to introspection and observation of the world. MJT demanded of me not that I study and take notes, but that I look beyond in all directions, both inwards and outward into the greater universe. While I recognize a class model like this is not possible in other courses, MJT has been an opportunity for growth, a time to tune out the constant hum of televisions and phones and instead focus my attention onto studies that activate my soul. Especially in this year, the year of COVID and the year of screens, MJT has been the setting for some of the deepest, realest conversations I have had. As a student with ADHD, I have often found it difficult to stay focused and on track in school. This year has only furthered my struggle, as online classes have made distractions much more readily available. Even in person, I catch myself fidgeting, doodling on pages, and zoning out. I've grown accustomed to the constant stimulation I receive from my phone, from my TV screen, and from the world of instant technology as a whole. MJT has pushed me to break the pattern of needing constant stimulation and the instant gratification of the digital world, instead showing me the beauty of silence, of thought, of listening, and sharing ideas. I may be a child of the internet generation, a victim of a pandemic that shortened my attention span and drained my motivation, but MJT has offered a form of education that has helped me unlearn what I knew. I am beginning to unlearn that knowledge is only power, that my grades represent my intellect and self-worth, that education is something that can never be finished. As I stand on the brink of greater education and on the final ledge of childhood, these are lessons that will guide me, philosophies that will motivate me to learn, not only for my diploma's sakes. Slowly, I am freeing myself of the numbing power of entertainment and reclaiming my inner person. The pandemic has heightened our attention to resiliency. We know a lot about how people cope with trauma. One researcher describes the importance of cultivating an attitude of tragic optimism, a term coined by Viktor Frankl, the Holocaust survivor and psychiatrist, defined as the ability to maintain hope and find meaning in life despite its inescapable pain, loss and suffering, a combination of honest reflection and the search for the good. Heschel, whose family was murdered in the Shoah, knew the tragedy of suffering well when he said this: "We have denied our young people the knowledge of the dark side of life, that life includes hardships, illnesses, grief, even agony. They do not feel morally challenged. They do not feel called upon. The young person of today is pampered. In moments of crisis, he breaks down easily under hardship." In modern Jewish thought, we study the biblical book of Job. We followed by material on post-Holocaust theology. This senior student reflection on hardship and Job is in the form of a letter to her parents. And I just want to say before reading these last two pieces is that what you'll hear in these last two pieces are, there's a lot to say in these pieces, but they both chose to do readings of the Book of Job, and their readings are quite different from one another. And that in and of itself is also interesting. As I have endured the difficulties and the pleasantries of being a high school student, the person I started as 4 years ago cannot compare to the person writing this letter to you today. Through this journey of learning to deal with the struggles of adolescence, I've gained what made me who I am today. Through classes like MJT and the difficulties I have endured, I was able to learn about myself. I was able to learn how to think and how to express myself in a world full of conformity and sameness. Wise people such as Abraham Joshua Heschel, David Foster Wallace, and commentaries on the Book of Job have forced me to deal with challenging questions. Through their writing, I have come to understand the significance of self-awareness as a key factor in facing adversity. While there may be a universal rulebook on how to fund society when life goes as planned, there's no universal rulebook on how to overcome adversity when life challenges us. With Job, for example, a normal man endures the challenges and the unfairness that life poses. While his friends are the ones that tell him how he had to have sinned in order to be suffering, Job cannot bear to see that as the truth. Even though everyone around Job tells him how he has to accept the tragedies that God has commanded him, he does not conform to their narrow thinking. Rather, Job challenges God and requests God to meet him in court. When God takes Job up on his offer and shows Job his insignificance and even his significance in this world, Job is able to overcome his inner turmoil and finally see clearly where he believes in God through his own lenses. In an event where the one suffering, Job, could either conform to the societal beliefs or give up on God completely, he does neither. He stays true to himself by living and enduring the uncomfortableness of being distressed and unsure in his own life. The ability to know yourself and be aware of your surroundings well enough to climb out of the many ditches of life, I believe, is the key. As a person who has fallen into many ditches throughout my short life, I have learned that the more I grow and am in touch with my own emotions and my own strengths and weaknesses, the more efficient and wise I become at helping myself deal with miseries. And I will not read the rest of this, but she goes on. And she concludes with, so thank you, Ima and Abba, for the opportunities you have given me to expand my understanding about the world and myself. I hope to continue to do so as I transition into adulthood. Heschel concludes with a note about the practicality of his vision. What is the concrete and practical consequence of the change of attitude I am pleading for? But first, I must propose a revision of the term practical. The term practical is usually associated with activities capable of being described in terms of charts and statistics. I should like to stress that acts that occur within the inner life of man, a thought, a moment of sensitivity, a moment of stillness and self-examination, the acquisition of a spiritual insight, this is supremely practical. And now a piece from the last student reflection. YOLO is the term my peers and I use to express the statement, you only live once. This is indeed true, however, it's odd. We make such an effort to create the most fulfilling life for ourselves, but in the grand scheme, we live an average of 79 years as less than a speck on an Earth, which is surrounded by planets, galaxies, and black holes. I feel the pressures of my smallness constantly. I'm just one in a number of millions. In the small time I have, why does it matter that I put a comma in the correct place? Why should I turn my homework in? When taking an approach to life, we could take the road of, it'll be over soon. Why work so hard? If I went down this crazy hole and continued my rant, I'd be in bed all day unproductively watching TV because sometimes man-made society caves in on me. We're basically zilch, yet we are so much. As Jeremy Kalmanowski says, we are born from dust, but we are living in the image of God. We have the ability to expand our little value to reach toward God's transcendence. Although we benefited from the extremely helpful efforts of Rochelle Zell and our families this year, we could have easily pushed this year could have easily pushed us to stop working hard. We have had the option to become indifferent this year, indifferent to the families and minorities struggling during these COVID times and the BLM movement. So why keep going? Why keep pushing ourselves to be our best? We keep going because we have a responsibility to recognize the abundant world we live in and also acknowledge the weakened parts of our society by racism and our lack of focus on the special parts of humanity. Life, no matter how small, has so much goodness to offer, but we have put aside the richness of life to make sure we check off every little thing on our to-do list. In the book of Job, God expresses the intention he put into every detail when creating the earth. After a treacherous journey, Job's able to accept his own smallness by understanding the world's enormity. Job is capable and encouraged to live a deeper life, to pay attention to what God worked so hard to establish. Before his realization, Job was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil. He completed his days by checking off boxes so he could squeeze by God and prevent harm to his fortune. He wasn't enjoying the true abundance of life. Like Job, we cannot understand the rationale for our smallness, but instead gain appreciation for what we have been given to reach new understanding. Right now, we are living a life like Job, prior to his confrontation with God. We are unable to recognize the sublime of humanity. We worry about our grades and our preparation for the academics and social scene of college. However, there is deeper meaning and potential in this world. And in school, we have the ability to achieve. And then I will skip a lot of her writing and just go to the end. The Jewish leaders we have read have pushed me to gain appreciation for what I have, yet understand my responsibility to integrate essential life elements of experiential learning, developing oneself and preventing indifference. I'm taking a gap year in Israel. I hope to meet people of varying races, religions, and social classes. My learning will launch my ongoing growth as a person, a Jew, and an activist. So what do we need the future of Jewish learning to be? We will have to adjust our educational standards to an enhanced conception of man, says Heschel, to endeavor to develop an aptitude and personal responsibility in every student for the preservation of the humanistic tradition of the West, a reverence for what man has thought concerning universality, justice, and compassion, that right living consists not only in the satisfaction of personal needs, but in responding to moral and spiritual demands. We need schools as sanctuary, not factory, study as worship, something that can counteract, quote, from Heschel, tribalism and self-centeredness, spaces of silence and song and study and care where we can hear Sinai's calling today. Because much has been given to us, much is asked of us, and so we must ask ourselves, what will life get of me? To conclude, I turn to Franz Rosenzweig, whom we have also studied over the years in modern Jewish thought, who writes, quote, teaching begins where the subject matter ceases to be subject matter and changes into inner power. I hope you have heard the inner power of our children tonight. Can you hear that song? May it be so.
Thank you so much. That was fascinating. And I love how you brought your students' learning, you know, forward into the discussion that we're going to have here tonight and the direct quotes from your students' thoughts. So we have a few questions. They range into being very specific to being very broad. I'm just going to start with a question on towards the beginning, you were doing Heschel's description of the age, and you were talking about how that your student, it still obtains, you know, to your students. Can you talk a little bit more about what your students have found most resonant about his description of the age?
Yeah, I think they just, you know, largely feel, there's a word that appears over and over and over again in his essay, and it's called instrumentalization, that they are instrumentalized. It is in the service of achievement, of success. High school is a grind. They are packaging and grooming and being groomed, and the pressure feels enormous, and it is in the service of everything he's identifying: affluence, status, money. and they feel it. They feel it. They feel the weight of it. So I think that is that is a huge dimension of what they feel. I think they also really feel the pressures to conform. You know, there's of course the normal, developmental social conformity. But with social media, of adolescence, right? But with social media, it's a 24/7. It's a constant curating of self. It's a constant putting of oneself, into the norms. And if one doesn't, just the stakes are so high and it feels relentless. I mean, again, a lot of normal adolescent developmental stuff, but I think the intrusion, the 24/7 intrusion of technology and social media has really just made it, all the more relentless.
Thank you. There was an incredible conceptual framework for all of this and then some great examples from the students. A couple of people were wondering in different ways. I'm reflecting a couple of different questions, which is, can you deepen your comments on how one avoids this culture of using learning as a tool for success and instead becomes the ideal that you're so describing, a little bit more like how do we shift this?
Yeah. I mean, it's a great question. How do we shift it? I think one of the challenges we have is ultimately they're structural. And the structures are way bigger than anything any individual anywhere can do, right, alone, let alone teenagers in a high school in Deerfield. So I think the way I think about it is because, I could make some suggestions here about some of the things that have been suggested about the kind of structural shifts that would go towards making college admissions less pressureful and then we could dial it back, right? I mean, if college admissions were different, then high school could feel different. But I'm wary of turning to the individual and laying blame on the individual when really there are deep structures that have to shift. We could talk about the kind of financial support and subvention that's necessary so that people, can live without feeling like the anxiety and angst over success and affluence, right? I mean, we could have all kinds of large scale conversations, which are not my area of expertise, but I would say in terms of the cultivation of consciousness, what I would say about schooling is that I think that you want to kind of provoke in students questions about what is. And so it's not to say that students can single-handedly change or should change or even want to change anything. It's just to raise awareness that conditions are conditions and they're not necessarily eternal. They're not necessarily transcendent. They're not necessarily universal. And they're not necessarily what ought to be. So we can raise questions about that. We can ask ourselves, how do we want to be in the world? And then if we're not, if we come to some conclusions, because, the Torah has a certain vision or, Judaism has a certain vision, and that vision seems really profound and resonant and meaningful, the students at RZ, and again, it's just a small little taste of it all, they feel what it means to kind of, think and cultivate human dignity, what it means to cultivate stillness, what it means to cultivate discipline. So they feel the power of that, but then what does one do with that, right? So I think part of it is giving them a taste, giving them a feel, giving them a possibility, and then they're going to, they're building all these skills, they're going to go out in the world, and hopefully they'll be invested and involved in projects that will, bring it all about.
Thank you. Rabbi Warner has a question.
Thanks. I was struck by part of your quotation from Heschel kind of early on, where he said that we need to teach our youth to think, to pray, to cry, and several other things. Do you think he was distinguishing between those as separate things, or do you think he saw them as interrelated? And the follow-up question, whichever answer you feel is the most appropriate, what are the implications for our pedagogy?
Yeah, those are great questions. Not being an expert on Heschel, where's Shai Held when you need him? My sense is that in this essay, in some ways, they all are kind of a piece, which is that while crying is different than thinking, they're all things that are required, that are necessary for expression, necessary for articulation of self, necessary for the kind of attunement that goes towards, awe, reverence, appreciation. Thinking leads to radical amazement. Crying comes from awareness of suffering, which is also about, right? It's awareness and attunement, right? So there's an affective component, there's an intellectual cognitive component. And I think, people want to talk about the difference between, the heart and the mind, right? And we certainly, tradition talks about that, pedagogy talks about that. And I think where you need to think about whole people. We use that language when we talk about elementary school education, but I think the implications for high school education and for human education is that we're talking about whole humans, right? But for cultivating what Heschel thinks we should be cultivating, then you got to do heart and mind and soul, right? We got to sit and be still. We've got to think well and hard, and we've got to express the inexpressible through tears, through song, through silence.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Rabbi Friedman has a question.
Thanks, Shikara, Dr. Schorsch. It's great to see you again and hear from you.
And good to see you too. Thank you.
You return again and again tonight to Heschel and to your students who really inspire us too. In your opinion, who today are the living scholars that the future generations will quote long after they pass?
It's a good question. My students are also really taken by Rabbi Green. They're also really taken by Rabbi Held. They're also really taken by Aviva Zornberg. So I think those are three good examples of people who might be quoted down the road. Heschel is imminently quotable, and he had that the prophetic kind of mode of expression, like the poetic mode of expression. So it's really not like an analytic mode, but it's a mode that lends itself to like liturgical kind of recitation. But I think those are some good examples of current Torah scholars that our students find really compelling.
Thank you.
Sure.
Great. Allie, do you have a question? All right. Allie is going to ask a question.
All right. I was entranced when you were talking about the notion of maladjustment. And I thought it was interesting. And I was thinking in roles as educators and in roles as sort of the heads of society at the moment, how do you think we can respond best to sort of questions of our own complicity in sort of the current inappropriate state of society from our students, if we're teaching them how to question, sort of how do we respond to the question that says sort of, where were you?
I think it's scary to be a parent. It's scary to be an adult because you get asked, right? But I think the flip side of that is, I recently read something about trust, like just trusting. It's relational. It's just relational. I think when you know someone well, those questions just come from such a place of relationality, and that's what goes on in the best of educational settings, right? That there's one thing for like the outsider to ask the question. There's another thing for the insider to ask the question. So when your child is asking the question, or when your student is asking the question, it's like, yeah, bring it on. And I think we have to have the courage to kind of look within as well, and to acknowledge, change, and acknowledge, where I can't imagine a household where we're not having those tough conversations around all kinds of things, right? And I think that we have to be willing to go there, I'm kind of with Heschel, where like a sensitive conscience, there's how are we ever getting complacent, right? And I think one of the exciting things about teaching, and one of the exciting things about parenting, it's a scary thing, but it's also an exciting thing, is like, it is the question, right? It is the question that keeps us alive and keeps us growing and learning. And, oh, I got to read that book, and I got to think about that, and I've got my work to do. And, Heschel thinks learning is a lifetime. So yeah, learning's a lifetime, And if we stop when we're 30, because we've been there, done that, and now we're raising our children, then what kind of role modeling is that, right? But it is scary. It's scary. But I think trust, I think relationships, I think knowing that the question is coming from a place of, curiosity and wonder, and not harsh, I'm with adolescence. So I've got a lot of tolerance for the rasha, I've got a lot of tolerance for the one who wants to be on the outside. I mean, but to be honest, like, where is the rasha these days? I mean, they're just, everyone's so good and well-behaved. It's like, where's the person really asking the hard questions? Like, no, but bring them on. Like, we need to stay honest. We need to stay open. We need to stay alive to like the world. But it is, it takes a lot.
Thank you.
So in a moment, I'm going to hand it over to Rabbi Kramer to wrap us up. But I wanted to, I don't know if you have a further comment, but I just wanted to reflect to you that your presentation tonight made me really feel the comparison between education and the ideals of Shabbat. And I never thought about it that before in that way, which I thought was really profound, that all the things that Shabbat represents actually should be what our educational system, the values that our educational system. So I thank you for that insight, because that's something that I'm, amongst many things, I'm definitely going to take away. So
yeah, that's a really well said. That's really well said. I'm so glad you picked that up. I mean, Heschel, it's a profound statement when he says schools should be more like sanctuaries, right? And it's true. I mean, all those sensibilities and qualities. Now, but I mean, we need to make money, and we need to, we need to have jobs, and so one can't live in Shabbat forever. But that's where I just still feel the power of Jewish studies, because we can kind of create these mini sanctuaries in places, and we don't have to feel all the pressures of the math department and the science department. We do have a luxury in the world of Jewish studies, which is not to say that we're not contributing to critical thinking that's gonna make you write great essays, that's gonna make you think well and be good at and smart and get good grades and all that, because we are contributing to that. But, wish we were in a world where that's not how we had to sell ourselves, And so, yeah, Shabbat every fifth period, come on in.
I'll sign up for that. So
yeah.
All right, I'm going to turn things over to Rabbi Kramer. Thank you very much, Dr. Schorsch.
Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Those who don't know me, I'm Rabbi Kramer. I'm the rabbi at Moriah. I want to conclude first by thanking you tremendously, Dr. Schorsch, for sharing your time, for sharing your great wisdom with us this evening. I would never want to go back to high school. But it was really great to sort of, get to experience what it was like for the students to be a student in your class. It was enlightening, inspiring. There's so much to think about. And it was really moving to hear and to sort of witness in this way, the way that you transform your students, the way that you teach them to use Jewish resources to sort of rebelliously confront the spirit of the age, to place relationships at the heart of meaningful learning, and to build as I think you referred to it, a community of integrity. It's clear that there are challenges, but to the extent that there are educators in the world like you, the future of Jewish learning is quite bright. So thank you again for teaching us tonight, and for helping us to reflect on what Jewish learning can be, and what we can be as Jews and as human beings. I also want to thank North Suburban Synagogue Beth El and Beth Shalom for their tremendous partnership. This type of community thing is wonderful, and something I'm very proud to participate in, and I know you guys are too. And then finally, to everyone who was on the Zoom, thank you all for joining us. It was great. Thank you for your questions. And I wish everybody a Chag Sameach, and have a wonderful night.
Chag Sameach. Chag Sameach.
Chag Sameach.
Everyone.
Chag Sameach. Thank you so much.